I'll talk a bit about BPO industry in Sri Lanka. The BPO industry in Sri Lanka has been, it's not that clear here. The BPO industry in Sri Lanka has been growing roughly 20% year on year in the last 3 years. Roughly speaking, there are 12,000 people working in outsourcing sort of work. Now, when I say 12,000, even IT workers, like say people at Virtusa, is in outsourcing, so they are also counted in that 12,000. Whereas pure BPO, like business processes, not IT type work, but data entry, call center type BPOs, is around 7,000, 6,500, 7,000. Now there's no exact count, but total 12,000 in outsourcing sort of work, IT around 5,000, the other 7,000 or 6,000, 6,500 in BPOs. So for a small country, it's not too bad, but when you compare with BPO industry leaders like India or Philippines, it's very small. In the world stage, we are very small. But then again, quality-wise, as well as certain industry improvement-wise, we've come forward a long way. In certain rankings, we actually in a good position. For example, late last year there was a report from IBM where they actually ranked outsourcing destinations, and Sri Lanka actually came at 12th position, while Philippines actually took over India. So Philippines at first, India second, and actually Sri Lanka is at 12th. So for a small country, we are not doing too bad. It's very relatively small in the world stage, but then again, in certain rankings, we are doing good. Financial accounting, we've actually been looked at as a special kind of center of excellence, if you like, because we actually have the skills, skilled people required for that. And I have a list of BPO companies here, and some of those companies happens to be at Orion City. There are two gentlemen here who come from Orion City, and they're, I think, trying to build the BPO hub in Sri Lanka. Now, in India, one thing is when you go to a BPO company, it's huge, right? So sometimes 10,000 seats, 15,000 seats in one building, you see this many people working because it's so huge. Whereas in Sri Lanka, it's not there yet. And one of the problems was the infrastructure issue, and overseas companies wanted to come here, but they couldn't find enough seats because you can't start a call center with 5 seats. It doesn't make sense to outsource for a company for 5 seats. You have to do it for maybe 50 seats, 100 seats, and I think Orion City is trying to do that for Sri Lanka. And the other issue, which I'll touch later, is the skills issue. I'll come to that in a minute. Yeah, now, BPO talent development. One issue was the infrastructure issue, and the other issue, as I see, is the human resource issue. As I said, if a company wants to outsource business processes to another country, they would do it if they can get significant benefits, significant cost savings. As I said, they wouldn't do it for 2 people, they wouldn't do it for 5 people. So you have to have a resource pool available. So the biggest challenge with Sri Lanka, apart from infrastructure, is the availability of human resources. Say, for example, I have a company from US coming to Sri Lanka for a call center, 500 seats. Can I guarantee 500 people in 1 month's time? The actual answer today is no. If I was asked for 10 people, I might be able to struggle and find 10. But if I was asked for 50, I would really struggle. Sometimes I meet people like job agents looking for 100 people for a call center, and they're really struggling. So, but if you were to go to India and find 2,000 people in 1 month, they actually can do it. 5,000 people in 1 month, they can actually do it. So one of the challenges for Sri Lanka is in bringing down projects, more projects, is this problem. You can't get a project if you don't have people. It's kind of a chicken and egg problem as well. Do you develop talent and wait for projects to come, because then people don't have work and you have to bring projects, or can you bring projects first and then develop talent? So there's this this problem. What do you do first? But whatever way you look at it, it's actually challenging the growth of the industry. If we had more resources available from a certain way, we could grow. Now, at the moment, it's growing, as I said, 20% year on year in the last 3 years, revenue-wise. That is kind of organic growth. You have 12,000 today, next year maybe 12,300 more projects. Yes, revenue has grown by 20%, but then again, 12,000 and 12,300, what's the big difference, right? We're talking about 15,000 people in one company in India. So yes, it has grown, but the talent is not there in Sri Lanka. So I'm slowly coming to where we are. This problem we identified as the biggest issue for the growth of the BPO industry. This gentleman might look at it from another angle and say infrastructure is an issue as well. It's the other way around, is it? So anyway, from our research, we thought, what are the challenges for the BPO industry, for the growth of the thing? And the thing that we came to was, it is the availability of resources. This is a bit different from IT, whereas you develop certain high-skilled people and you can slowly grow. Whereas BPO, it's a numbers game. You have to build the numbers. So we figured this problem out, and the research also indicated no one's actually developing talent in Sri Lanka in a focused way. There were a couple of projects around. ICTA was doing some awareness sessions and trying to fund training activities, but then again, we're still talking about that 12,000 versus 12,300, you know. There was no talent development project for Sri Lanka. And the research also indicated that in the world stage, there are global standards for BPOs. Now, like IT degrees or marketing degrees, for BPOs, actually, there are qualifications as well. So we happened to discuss with a body called BPO Certifications Institute, which happens to be the global body for BPO credentialing, as it is called. So what they do is, it's like CIMA, you know, they have the knowledge body as well as the expertise, and they get partners in certain countries, train people, and at the end they issue the CIMA certificate. Likewise, BPO Certifications Institute, BCI for short, they have a BPO knowledge body, and they have certifications for end-to-end BPO activities, and they have partners in different countries training BPO talent, and then finally issue a BPO certificate. And the benefit we thought with this, the valuable thing is it's a global certification. One of the issues that people have with BPO industries is like, is it a career? Like, can I go overseas with it, or can I move to another company with this? Am I limiting my career opportunities? Like, people have these things. So we thought with BPO certifications, because it's a global thing, spread across 40 plus countries, etc. I don't know. Okay. Yeah, it's spread across 40 countries, and about 50,000 people annually get certified with this certification. So we thought, if we implement something global here in Sri Lanka, we might be able to attract more people. And once they are certified, they can go overseas or they can move around in companies, because we are actually getting people to one standard rather than some local standard. Okay, so we discussed with this body, and they weren't in Sri Lanka, and one of the reasons for them not coming to Sri Lanka earlier was the war, because they had thought, like, there aren't companies coming to Sri Lanka for BPOs, and doing talent development isn't that important, and the security and all that was a concern. So myself and one of my friends, we got together as business partners and a very young team, you know, and we actually discussed with this world body, and they were happy to come to Sri Lanka, and we started Lanka BPO Academy. We started Lanka BPO Academy, which is the only BPO training institute in Sri Lanka, and our objective is to train people for the BPO sector. And when I say BPOs, for all sort of BPO areas that I indicated initially, 4 high level areas: 1 financial accounting, 2 call center customer service, 3 business processing, data processing, number 4 technical support. We don't do technical support at the moment because there are a lot of IT qualifications around and we don't think that's our place. So we are more in customer service, data processing and financial accounting. And our objective is to help talent development for Sri Lanka. And the way forward, as I see, because the war is over, it's easier to attract investors. So I think we need to bring BPO projects slowly now, but more from a small to medium size point of view. You know, we still can't handle projects of 100 or more, but we can look at 50 to 100 range, and that investor attraction has to happen. And that's partly BPO industry's role. Like, there's an industry association and they need to take the role, SLASCOM, but also government as well. Now, in India, their BPO industry grew from 1990 to, say, 2005.
Late 90s.
Late 90s, isn't it? Yes. And government really supported that. They changed the tax regime, they changed certain business parameters in the country so that more work came to India. And I think there has been a lot of talk about improving the BPO sector in Sri Lanka, but I don't think certain key things have been done. And one area is investor attraction and the investor facilitation as well, like how you facilitate an investor. Because sometimes there's a lot of administration processes involved, and I personally know certain companies actually go back because the administration process is so hard. So it's not just a BPO thing, it's a common thing. Could be IT, could be manufacturing, could be garments, but that has to be streamlined. And then the infrastructure issue, which these gentlemen are looking at. Yes?
Just to let you know, mm-hmm. for everybody here,
please,
that even though India started late 90s, the first BPO operation actually started in Sri Lanka.
Right.
In 83.
Okay.
And that company is still here. It was under the name of data entry.